all right?
Yeah.
Cool. Well, welcome. Today we're going to be going through a ton of JavaScript fundamentals. The goal here is to orient folks who are a little bit experienced with JavaScript to a medium amount of experience with JavaScript, or people who have some familiarity with another language. So we're going to be really tearing through this stuff. I suspect that you all are comfortable enough with programming languages in general that if I coast over C-like syntax, you'll be all right. However, we do have a ton of TAs walking around. So if there's pretty much any question you have that's going to block you from making progress on your own project or on the curriculum that is up here, JSConf2014.hackerreactor.com, you can find a GitHub repo. If you have any trouble with any of that, flag down one of the TAs who are going to be circulating. They will be circulating in the half-hour sections after the lecture. So I'm going to shoot for talking for about an hour, and then give you guys a half hour to work on the stuff you find there. Cool. So all of the TAs are over there in the back right now, but they'll be wandering around later. Are there any questions about that stuff? Do you guys get the format of the class? It's going to be hands-on to whatever degree you want to make it. All right. So during these lectures, I'm also going to kind of like make it as hands-on and interactive as possible. In a lot of classroom settings, you're going to be expected to sort of like stay quiet and don't rock the boat. This isn't that place. We're going to be trying to interact as much as possible. I really want to engage with the questions you guys actually have, if that makes sense. So in my pretty extensive time as a teacher, I have noticed that people feel really uncomfortable asking questions if they think that the people around them know a bunch of stuff that they don't know, or maybe their question doesn't make sense or isn't pertinent. And that's almost never the case. It's very, very rarely the case, if ever, that you have a question that isn't shared by a sufficient number of people that you'll hear like an almost audible sigh of relief when you ask that question. So I guess what I'm going to ask of you guys is that you be as forthcoming as possible anytime you're confused about something. I'm going to be calling on you. This is not to sort of like mess up your day. This is basically, I need some way of knowing how well I've explained a concept. And so I'm going to sort of like test that by checking how well I've done explaining things along the way and asking you guys questions. If you have a question and you ask it, or if you answer a question, we'll throw you a t-shirt or something cool. So hopefully you guys can do the uncomfortable and be super interactive. Okay, so before I get started, or rather, before I get started with the lecture content, I'd love to take a quick sampling of what you guys already know. So you there in the front, you're sitting in the front. What do you know about JavaScript so far? Like, how comfortable are you with it? What kinds of applications are you writing, if any?
I can read it, I can write it. I've done some web methods, some page methods, this interaction with JavaScript, interacting with the controls. But and most of it's just on-page stuff. You know, I want to add a checkbox to a grid view.
Got it. So read and write some jQuery.
jQuery.
Yeah, curious how the language works in fact, in its details.
Yeah.
I get it. Awesome. You there. You're sitting in the back. Yes.
Me.
No, behind you. You're not actually sitting in the back. What kind of JavaScript do you read and write? How much are you coming into the room already knowing? It doesn't have to be a lot. I don't need to put you guys on the spot for like, you already know JavaScript, right? Great, let's all go to lunch. No.
Writing a lot of backbone apps.
Writing backbone apps. All right, sweet. So let's get two more. You there with the sort of, yes?
I went through the fundamentals very quickly so that we could work on a backbone project. But I write CoffeeScript all day.
Got it. Okay, so you learned the fundamentals sort of rapid fire. And it was kind of piecemeal, and now you're already expected to write, you know, support the backbone app in some sense.
Yeah.
Got it. That's a classic story. That's how I learned What I know is, having been thrown into the deep end of a code base, I interviewed for my first job in the Bay Area, and I interviewed with this really nice guy. He was awesome. I was like, all right, yeah, I'll take this job. This sounds great. And plus, I was new. I needed to figure out some way of learning stuff. And I showed up, like, 3 weeks later, I moved from out of town, and he was gone, and the whole team was gone. Everyone had quit. I was the only person. I was running, like, the largest photo sharing website on the internet at the time, and I was like, so who's running my orientation? They're like, you are the team, bro. Good luck. They had duplicated the code base every time there was a new page. So there were like three copies of all the same JavaScript in line with HTML, and I didn't know best practices, so I was like, is that really how you're supposed to do it? You just copy the whole file every time. Okay, interesting. All right, so I know the feeling. And then lastly, you in the back.
Yes.
What is your level of JavaScript? How can I best tune what we're talking about today to you as a representative of the whole audience?
I would rate myself intermediate.
Okay. What kinds of things do you find yourself, like, what's an example question that you've had that you've been like, huh, I don't actually know how that works?
It's more, I think, best practices than anything. You know, I can buy with find on the internet. No formal sort of training, just self-taught.
All right, so this is awesome. This tells me I'm going to set the bar just a little bit over intermediate. Some of you, it sounds like, will know a fair amount of this, but the interesting thing I found is that all of these details of JavaScript are kind of glossed over, and furthermore, when they are talked about in conferences and in talks like this, they're talked about like weird little idiosyncrasies that should be laughed at and then moved past as if they have no meaning or value at all. It's like, look at this, when I type two curly braces, it's not an object. Isn't that weird? Anyway, next slide. There's reasons for all of the nuances of how JavaScript works, and we're going to try to unearth those things and make them have some structure. So even if you're pretty experienced, I hope you will treat this content as containing a lot of little nuggets that are going to clarify quite a bit. If you are finding it difficult to keep up, please do not worry. That's what the TAs are for. I need you guys to feel super comfortable asking them questions. So let's dive into the objects and functions section. Okay, so, wait, sorry, jumping forward. Objects, property access. So this is an object, approximately speaking. I don't know how well you guys can see. It's a little small. So that's an object literal. Those are two curly braces next to each other. And conceptually, if you were to put that into a variable, that variable would hold a reference to an object. What is an object exactly? Basically, every value in JavaScript is an object. An object is any value that has the ability to store properties. In JavaScript, that's kind of every value. So it's kind of a tautology. When someone says object, they might mean one of two things. They might mean one of these values that doesn't have any interesting subtype. So like number is an object, but it's a subtype of object. Number has a lot of other interesting things about it. A given number like 9 will have special methods on it, like tofixed and things like that, that do number-related work. And when you say object, you might mean something that doesn't have any such subtype. It's just an object, and that's the only interesting thing about it. You otherwise might mean it's just any value at all. It's not a variable, it's not an expression, it's an object. So these two meanings can be a bit confusing because when you talk about an object, you might be talking about a number or you might not, right? You might be specifying a non-number, non-array, just entity that is capable of storing key-value pairs. So here we have an object stored in OBJ, and we have the ability to add properties to it. I'm using a specific syntax here. This is bracket syntax, and I'd like to start from the assumption that bracket syntax is the only way that it works. We're gonna move on to other aliases for this, but in general, you can look at an object with brackets to the side of it as the way that you interact with the aspects of that object. So, as with any object-oriented language, you want to store a bunch of associated things together in an object. you can use this for the pattern of storing items in a hash table if you had like a phone book or something like that. And the key is the stringified thing. Once you want the object later, you just access it by not having an equal sign. So this logs, what do you think? Right, so for brevity's sake, I took off console dot on everything and I assumed the existence of a log function.
So the only idea is reference as an array and not an object?
That's a very good question. The question was, is obj an array and not an object? No. So, we're about to see dot syntax down the line, but for now I'd like you to pretend you've never seen a dot ever in JavaScript. And you'd be tempted to think, perhaps, depending on what languages you've come from, you might be tempted to think that because we're seeing brackets next to this obj thing, we are doing array access. But that's not the case. This is how you assign properties in JavaScript. Basically, this line says, take this value, whatever's on the right of the equal sign, and put it into the object at the key x. So what would you expect in that case to be logged when we access the key x down here? Exactly. So, what happens when we access obj? You there in the blue who's typing and I'm being worried by disturbing. What do you think might be accessed, logged when we log obj bracket y?
Undefined.
Undefined. So, he's out in front. The reason undefined is logged is we've never set a property for y. Any object that you interact with at a key that isn't already defined will give you undefined. It's just a default response. The language has a few interesting absent values, values that represent nothingness of some sort or another. So we can think of a ton of them. How many different sort of falsy values can you think of? False, zero, undefined, null. These all kind of mean some absence of things. The two that are the most confusing for people are undefined and null. Undefined means I don't know. It's generally a flag in the language that gets passed around when some answer is not known. Null means there is no such thing. So in this case, by accessing object bracket y, we might expect to get null because we know there isn't any property at y. But the language has chosen to pass the I don't know value in response. It's not an awful choice. It kind of works out. It breaks our rule. The rule is undefined means I don't know. Null means there's no such thing. I've checked, and I'm positive about that. So here's the interesting part, and this is probably the most important takeaway of the objects section. These two syntaxes, obj bracket quote, x quote bracket, is absolutely equivalent to obj dot x. The two mean the same thing. If you haven't seen both syntaxes used to access the same property, you could be confused in a perfectly reasonable way. I get the sense that this fellow in the front has some programming experience and it's exactly the type of language feature that would mislead people who are coming from any other context at all. But as it happens, these two mean the exact same thing. This is a shorthand that makes method access easy. Certain types of properties you're going to want to look up a little bit faster, and that's what this is supposed to support. You can less typing, not a ton less typing, but it looks better. So. You're allowed to mix and match, as you can see down here. The brackets can be present or absent from the access, and they can be present or absent from the assignment. The reason we have this is primarily so that we can access dynamic properties. In this case, imagine you have a variable key that stores the string x. You would be allowed to substitute the string in between the brackets for that variable name. Can you think of why this might be useful? Take a moment to reflect on why it might be super important that the language supports the ability to have either a string or a variable in between these brackets. Both cases are necessary. So in the green hat, what do you think the grave importance is to being able to use variables between brackets?
To make it more dynamic, I guess, like if you have something defined somewhere and
I'm going to pounce on the first part of what you said because it's absolutely correct. To make it dynamic.
Dynamic, yeah.
One way to state that is if you don't know while you're writing your program what key to look up, you would be screwed without bracket access. You need some way of specifying a property, a key that you're interested in at runtime, not at program definition time, right? That's what variables are really good for. They can store values that the user inputs or that are generated randomly. So you need this bracket access. That's why I start by, he gets a shirt, it's cool.
I'll take a question later.
Yeah.
Make up for it.
Radical. You need bracket access to make it possible to access any values that you can't know while you're typing the program. Why do you need, yes?
So if you're storing something like in an object literal that you're talking about, say, like, for example, in Java, I'm doing something like a hash map, and there's a reason I'm using a particular data structure. Would you consider an object something like that? Because, you know, for faster lookups, as opposed to iterating over an array?
Absolutely. So the question is, would we use objects the way we would use hash tables in Java? Hash maps in Java? Absolutely. In JavaScript, the intent of an object is twofold. Number one, you might want to encapsulate related pieces of behavior and data for object-oriented programming purposes. So in the case of Java, you would expect to see this as an instance of a class, or possibly just an encapsulation, right? The second thing you can do in JavaScript that objects are used to support is for hash maps. For any time you want the ability to in constant time, associate a key or some other access. It always has to be a string, but you'd have to stringify some sort of an access token and have it mapped directly in constant time to any value, right? So here we see it's unclear which pattern we're using, but both of them are pooled together. Anytime you do key access, you're going to be using an object. Okay, so this example should really send home the idea of dynamic property access. If the key was whatever letter the user types, we couldn't possibly have specified it in advance, so we couldn't possibly use dot access. Does that make sense? The value of brackets is that it lets us put anything we want, even dynamically generated stuff, in between those brackets, and we can access the key that represents. You can write JavaScript without any periods for the rest of your life if you want. It won't look very good, but you can do it. Okay, I would like to go through some errors that people make when they try to apply these ideas. Basically, this is like a truth table where we're gonna be flipping bits in a truth table and realizing that only one of the arrangements was valid. So you can't put quotation marks around a variable name and expect it to log anything meaningful. Why would you say that is in the pink? What do you expect to happen here with the code on the last line? What do you expect it to log? Sorry, in the pink here. Apologies. I know that people self-select because here's the interesting thing. When you let people sort of announce what they know, then whoever happens to get the thing you just said says what they know, and it creates an illusion that the entire room is further out on the topic than you are. Even though only one person at a time is called upon and they're self-selected, I don't want to create that illusion. So I expect this to go poorly for both of us because I just picked somebody at random. You are all in this position, and if you don't understand what's going on, I want you to feel super comfortable being the person who asks the question. So what could we hope for this line to to log, even though I haven't told you the answer yet. Yeah.
I don't think that it knows what key in parentheses is, because the variable name equaling x, it can't reference that x is 9.
So you're saying that in here, this is not related to this?
I'm not sure.
That's fair.
I would think not.
Okay, you're absolutely right. It is not, because when you put quotation marks around a name in JavaScript, an identifier, what you have is a string literal. It specifies that the language should generate an in-memory string object. It does not specify that a lookup should be done on a variable name. So there are basically two ways you're ever going to see a word appear in a JavaScript program. One is as an identifier, like a variable name, and the other is as a string, and that'll be wrapped in quotes. So in this case, we've confused which language syntax we're trying to use. And on this second line here, we put quotation marks around something that I can see here is intended to be a variable name. Does that make sense? There are reasons that people make this mistake that we're about to see. They're related to the other parts of the truth table that we're going to explore that don't work. But just know that you got to pick one or the other. Something is either a variable name or it's a string. And in this case, putting quotes around a variable name didn't work. So given what we learned with the logging of x and having y in quotation marks, do you remember what that logged in the white t-shirt?
Having it in quotes?
Yeah, earlier.
It was 9, wasn't it?
No, earlier, sorry. Earlier on in one of the slides, it was log obj bracket quote y, end quote.
Oh, it was undefined. Right?
Log's undefined. So, what do you think this is going to log in this actual situation?
Undefined.
Absolutely. Okay, here's another thing you can't do. You can't use dot access in combination with a variable name. Why not? Any ideas? How about you there with the glasses? Why can't you use a dot in conjunction with a variable name to get access to the property with the key K-E-Y?
I think you're trying to use a method.
What's that?
I think you're trying to use a method.
This is a really great suspicion. It doesn't happen to be true, but the idea was maybe it's because it tells the language I'm trying to access a method. That's not actually what it is. I will show you. So we're going to rely on two things we learned. The thing we just learned, which was you can't put quotation marks around a variable name. We knew that, right? That seemed almost obvious. And earlier, we learned the meaning of a dot. What was the meaning of a dot? Right there, in with the yeah.
Meaning of the dot, it's equivalent to your bracket.
Yes, quote. A dot expands to bracket, quote, end bracket, or bracket, quote, bracket, right, around the thing to the right of the dot. So let's take a look at this example right here. obj.key is going to expand into?
Bracket, quote, key, quote, bracket.
Exactly. In your mind, as we said, you can substitute the dot for some surrounding brackets and quotes. They are exactly equivalent. So here we have the same problem we explored a moment ago. We can't do this. We can't put quotation marks around a variable name and expect it to mean anything. So this is the first moment we've kind of gone off the rails, right? Because everything up until now has felt like, yes, we've heard of variables, thank you. But we're sort of assembling these small, simple ideas together into something that surprises most people. So before I move on, I just want to make sure I've answered any questions that there are. Does anyone have a question about the stuff that we've covered up until this point of not being allowed to use dot access with a variable name? Yeah?
Is there a performance difference based on accessing the property?
This is a great question. Is there a performance difference depending on which of the two you use? So my technically correct answer is yes, there is a minor performance difference. The answer that I think is more important is please don't be distracted by minor performance differences. Now, I don't know the nature of your question. You might be writing very low-level library code that needs to ship to a bunch of people. You might be hacking, you might be contributing to jQuery. I somewhat doubt that you're contributing to jQuery, and for that reason, I think that this question represents a way that people spend their attention and focus as they're writing their code that I would like to implore everyone to stop doing, right? Have you ever seen the pattern with a for loop? For, var, I equals 0, comma, length, semicolon, while I is less than length. Have you ever seen this before? In code, maybe not, yeah, it looks like it. This is one of those meaningless optimizations. As it happens, there are techniques now in modern engines to optimize that out for you, so these savings are made automatically, and you should not really be writing it in your code. But in rare cases and in some browsers, it becomes important to do this sort of thing. The problem is, people get attached to this idea of performance improvements on a tiny scale, and they miss the big scale performance improvements or the big scale code clarity. It's very unlikely you're going to be able to optimize your code in any perceivable way to the user with that change. However, to be less of a jerk about your question, yes, you're absolutely right. You can expect it to run really slow if you ever use bracket access. Basically an unusable program at that point. Yeah, you might as well be just answering the questions personally. That's how slowly your program will run. So let's move back to this version of the world. I just sort of like reset our code back a little bit, took out the key variable. And I'd like to make clear that you can't do this either. You cannot say obj bracket, and then with no quotes, the key that you're interested in, the string of the key that you're interested in. Everybody does this. Everybody who's starting to write JavaScript does this wrong. Some people who've been writing JavaScript for quite a while do this wrong. It's an easy mistake to make. What do you expect this to actually do?
It's going to try to find variable x.
Exactly.
Its value for it.
It's going to look for the variable x. I mean, this is just that fundamental distinction in most every programming language between a string and a variable identifier. We have not put quotation marks around what we intend to be a string, and so we are communicating the idea of a variable. That variable in this program has never been defined. So this is actually going to throw an error. The other reason that you have brackets is for special characters. If you want to use a key that has a bunch of interesting stuff in it, like spaces and dots, you're going to need to use bracket access. This is one of those cases where, even if it was more performant to use dot access, you kind of don't have a choice. You're forced. There is no way to type a key that has a quotation mark in it. Imagine wanting to store the phone number of Alice Bentley, right? Alice space Bentley. You need the ability to look up Alice space Bentley's phone number by name. But you are prevented from doing so by the nature of the language. You would say phone book dot Alice space Bentley, and that looks like something very different from the property access. You would have to do phone book bracket quote Alice space Bentley end quote end bracket. All right. So this of course is going to log cat. This is what you're not allowed to do that I sort of just illustrated, because all of that. Stuff in the middle is going to be thought of as code, and it's going to try to run it as code. We are done with that section. I want to tell you guys about object literal notation. This is another major source of errors for people. So here we have the object that I built up over the course of my examples, and I'm pointing to the creation of the object with A, and the assignment of properties with B. All right. These two steps can be done in unison. The way you would do it is by moving the end bracket, the end brace, down past the assignments, and you would move away from this assignment notation, and you would move toward property notation. So the red code there is what we used to write when it was assignment notation. We're going to remove all of that red code. That is not appropriate to have in the middle of an object literal. The rest of the red code here is going to be transformed a little bit. The equal signs get turned into colons. The semicolons get turned into commas, for the most part. The last one is not used. So this may look familiar to you. You've probably already seen plenty of object literal syntax. But here's the thing that most people get confused about. A lot of people will open an object literal like this, but they will find themselves writing statements in the middle of it. They will be mixing together statement notation, maybe an if statement, for example, with object literal property notation. Because the two look so similar, that looks very similar to that. And so people just kind of, when they're starting out, get the two confused and start doing work, doing like programmatic work in the middle of an object literal. And this is what you want to avoid doing. So that's the whole transformation you do in order to move from statement notation to object literal notation. Are there any questions about object literals and property notation?
So if
yeah.
you want to pass in the log where it says 9, if you want to pass obj and inside the brackets obj again, what would that do?
Ah, great question. The question was, if I put obj and then brackets, and then obj inside that, what would that do? I'm going to come back to that, because that's actually in my slides or similar to it.
Okay.
Remind me if when we get to key stringification, I don't remember to mention that. Okay. The other interesting thing is that the quotation marks in object literal notation are optional. You can just leave them off, provided one thing is true. What do you think that thing is? You there. Doing the headlines. Yes, that. Certainly. Nope. Three rows in front of you. I'll call on you on time, I promise. What do you expect to be the constraint on this opportunity that I just pointed out? You can leave the quotation marks off of a key in property notation unless it's implied. If you were writing this language and you were like, I wonder if I can have them never use quotation marks in their keys in the property notation syntax, you would immediately run into a problem and you'd say, actually, no, they have to use quotation marks from time to time.
If it means something else?
What's that?
If it means something else already?
If x were a variable, this is a great hypothesis. It's actually not true, but the language could have been written in that way, and it's not. And I think the folks from other languages are going to need to hear this. It's not the case that if you leave the quotation marks off, it's going to do a variable lookup. It's still going to be treated as a string. So whatever is on the left of that colon will always be wrapped in quotation marks. However, the exception, and thank you for playing, the exception that you're absolutely going to need quotation marks for is this second example. There's all of that code in the key. There's all of that special sigil, the space and the dot. We cannot get rid of those quotation marks on the second key. If you're using special characters in your key, you're going to have to wrap it in quotation marks. That's the whole rule of object literals.
Quick question.
Yeah.
So does that mean that these properties are automatically namespaced?
Namespaced to the object?
To the object.
Yes, so the question was, does that mean the properties themselves are namespaced to the object? Yes. You could not, for example, on this line, say log x. X is only a property of obj, so you must say log obj dot x or obj bracket x. Great question. Any other questions about objects or object literal notation?
Do you use signs that they can follow along with?
We do not.
Previous
slide.
No, I just
want
to use like a little thing.
Oh, that's
all right. Do you actually have this online and I can follow along
with it? Certainly. That's a great question. What I would love to do is I would love to, first of all, you guys are doing fantastically. I don't think I've ever been at a conference where people start talking this much, this quickly. I usually have to do a lot more t-shirt giving and begging and that sort of thing. In my class at Hack Reactor, I should have told you what we do. We have a school that brings people to full-time development level developers within 3 months. And the way that we do this is we've iterated on this curriculum quite a bit, and we have a pretty direct route to getting this information into people's heads. It depends on two things. One, we've had to break down these concepts quite a bit. You probably have noticed that there are some things you haven't heard said quite this way before. That's one half of how we do this. The other half of how we do this is by making sure that people don't treat this like a normal educational environment. And so the idea of asking a lot of questions and treating your own curiosities as if they are relevant to the whole room, that's very crucial to us moving at the pace that we need to in order to get through all of this material. Believe it or not, we will move much faster if you feel comfortable asking questions and seemingly slowing it down. It will not slow it down. It will prevent me from doing a lot of sidetracks. There will come a little shift in the middle of this day where I will come to trust you as asking me most of the questions that you have. And I will stop doing sidetracks because I can tell that you guys are volunteering whenever you're confused. So, as it pertains to this question, we don't have slides online and I actually prefer it that way. I would love to make them online eventually for you guys to come back and reference, but I can't promise that I will. The reason I like them not being online is I need you to keep me in check with being very clear right now, if that makes sense.
Yeah, it's just if later on we do like exercises, it's so much easier for me to go back and go, what then?
Yeah, that's totally reasonable.
But I don't remember.
It's a fantastic resource, and when that happens, I hope that our TAs will be able to illustrate it as much as you need. So, but very reasonable. One day. Stringification of keys. Yes?
I have one more question about the quotation marks involved with special characters.
Yep.
Was that just for demonstration purposes, or is there a occasional valid use where you would want to have that much information?
Yes, in that you're saying, is there a situation where it is ever useful to have an object that has keys on it, where those keys include special characters?
Right.
The answer is yes. Imagine that you were defining a phone book. You wanted to write a big JSON data blob of data. And the phone book includes people's real names. Real names have spaces in them. Even if you were to sort of like not need spaces, if you were to, you know, use a convention of some sort where underscores mean spaces, you might have special characters like E with an accent on it, right? So, great question. Yep?
Just for the bracket notation, there's no... You can use a var to define the value of the key. There's no reason you couldn't use a function for that too, right?
You said the word var and the word function. Let me just fit those into your question. You said, regarding bracket notation, help me understand where var comes in.
So you can use the value of a variable to define the key.
Use a value of a variable
so
to define the key. Ah, yes, certainly. So let's go back to that example.
There you go.
Right there.
Right. So there's no reason that couldn't be a function call either, right?
Ah, could I substitute key in this case with my special string generator function, paren paren, which might be similar to this situation, get letter from user.
Right. Could you just pass get letter from user directly into the bracket?
You could. You could take this entire thing that is currently being stored in the variable key. You could place that expression, that function call expression, inside these brackets, provided you're including the two parens, which say invoke this function and get the letter from the user. In that case, you can do that. You can put any expression inside the brackets. You could put some math inside the brackets if you want. And we're gonna see why with key stringification. But yes, any expression. Great question. So, because we're allowed to use any crazy strings of characters we want, we're also allowed to use strings that look like digits. We can access obj bracket quote 0, of course, because 0 is no more interesting than e with an accent on it, right? That seems intuitive, I hope. When you do so, you're allowed to iterate across all of the keys, whether they're numeric looking or letter looking, or whether they are they have special characters of any sort in them, using this for in syntax. This is the first type of iteration that you should probably start with. So what do you expect this to log? By every element, you mean 9 and cat?
Yeah.
It seems reasonable. In many languages, you could expect it to log the elements inside the object. It actually logs the keys. So in this case, it will log x and 0 as strings. It will log the strings x and 0. So here's the interesting part. And I put this down here, this iteration, so that we can see what is inside the object. What keys actually exist in this object? I'm allowed to take the quotation marks off of numbers because numbers stringify to the digit representation of themselves. I'm going to show you this operation. Is being done to everything you put between brackets. The gold code is substituted in by the browser, by the engine. So whenever you put anything in between the brackets, you can suppose that this gold code is being wrapped around it. Who was it? Was it you who asked about a function call in the group? No, behind you. You said, what if there was a function call? If it was a function call, mentally substitute quote x quote with get letter from user paren paren, that should result in a string. It should evaluate down to a string, and then that whole thing is wrapped in parentheses, and toString is called on it. It's already a string, so in that case, nothing surprising would happen. But here's the interesting part. Zero will be stringified to quote 0 end quote. When you call toString on a number, you get the digit representation of that number as a string. Yeah.
Isn't it better though? I mean, maybe we'll get into this, but sticking to a pattern versus one or the other.
Sure. Oh, you're saying wouldn't we always want to put quotation marks around our keys just so that it looks consistent? That's pretty reasonable. And in fact, the reason we're having a talk right now, where a room full of people who came in knowing a fair amount about JavaScript are discussing this, is because it's so misleading. So I think that's a very reasonable intuition. It is very misleading that we are allowed to both use quotes or not use quotes, but only for some things. We can only leave quotes off of digits and expect it to work right. We can't, for example, leave quotes off of a string. We already saw that was a problem. So yes, the intuition is fair. Let me show you why you will come to prefer this feature. Let me just answer that and I'll be right back. I'm gonna have to tell you because it's very far away in my slides. I thought it was the next transition. If you had a variable that stored a number, as you do in, say, iteration over the indices from 0 to length, right? Then you would just say, please get me the value at, say, 5, right? But 5 is represented in a variable, like I. So you say, get me the value stored at, and then you do some math. It's a number, or it's length minus 1, right? You want that to work. You want it to work that you can put a number, or a variable that contains a number, inside the brackets, and it will treat it just like array access in other languages. Yep.
How does it decide what order to put this thing in? The x and the 0?
Ah, the order, what, how do we decide what order the things get logged in? I think this is actually not specified in the language. So in fact, it's in practice, they all do it in order of insertion, but it's not guaranteed. Order is not guaranteed in this process. No one has implemented an engine where the fact that order is not guaranteed has been relied upon for speed improvements, and perhaps they're all terrified to do it because they assume that a bunch of programs have been written that depend on the historical sequencing of keys. Good question.
Yeah. That's why I was asking you about the hash map, because when you iterate over a hash map, there's no guarantee of order, mm-hmm. and the reason the key is always unique. So, I mean, you have a payload going into the hash, and if so there are no collisions, you know. So if you access something, that's why it's so fast. Mm-hmm. And that's why I was asking the question, if the object, like if you create a, if you have a huge data structure and you start inserting keys, you will not get it back in an order. And if you have to sort through it, it's expensive, you know, if the payload is big.
Right.
So, yeah.
So you generally don't use an object with the intent of getting an ordered list back or having to order that list after the fact. You tend to find yourself using objects when you need a specific value, and you're only interested in that one value, but you want it in constant time. Say, I want the value with the key, whatever, and that's probably the only one you want. You don't tend to store large collections that you're going to want to resequence. So, given that these things are going to be stringified, we can leave off the quotes if it's a digit, because it's going to be turned into that same string version of that digit. We can mix and match, because the two string is happening in both cases. However, what we can't do is leave the quotation marks off of the string for the reasons we've explored. And now this is the interesting part, in my opinion. When we log it later, it logs the string version of that number. That's because, as we saw, on the way in, it's being stringified. It's not possible for a key in an object to be anything but of type string. All right, if there are no more questions, I think this array section will clear up some of what you might want. So, I said earlier that every value in JavaScript is an object. And I want to really prove that. People have a bunch of rules in their minds about arrays, and a bunch of rules about functions, and those rules just don't actually exist in the language. The language does very little with arrays and objects, and I will show you what it is, but first I'm going to show you what it isn't. I'm going to show you how much the rules about objects pertain completely and exactly to arrays. First, imagine substituting obj equals curly braces for array equals brackets. These brackets generate an array. They tell the interpreter, hey, make me a brand new array object. And now, we have to call into question all of the things that were logged before. I'm going to cross them off and say, what do you expect to be logged when we access array bracket x? This is where it gets interesting for me. You there with the glasses. What do you think this line here is going to log? Log array bracket quote x, given that array bracket quote x was set to 9 up here, using the object style assignment, even though this is now an array rather than an object. And I apologize, I don't actually mean what do you expect as a JavaScript expert. I mean what do you expect as a human being.
Oh, you would think that it would log 9, but...
You would hope so, wouldn't you?
Yeah, but array bracket 1...
Right now you're saying the thing that I'm trying to teach you not to think. Oh. You said, I would expect it to log 9, certainly. But arrays something, something, something. That's the part you can skip. You don't have to think about arrays as being interesting or different in pretty much any way. This is array. This is property access. That's property access. And therefore, we're going to do all of this too stringy stuff on it. This is 9. We're logging 9 because it's just an object. We haven't talked about anything interesting to do with arrays yet. And the stuff to do with arrays that is interesting will be non-intrusive. There will be no impositions on your understanding of how objects work. And so everything that's true of objects will be true of arrays. Generally takes a while for that to sink in. Yep, it's actually true of arrays. So, next question. Moving on to the array access using numbers. Using numbers in between brackets. What do we expect to be logged here, you in the far back?
The value of the first key in the array, which I don't think I know right now.
The value of the first key in the array, meaning what? Like the first thing that was added to the array as a, using some sort of an array type interaction. If a push had happened. So this is my favorite part of the lecture because I get to examine a statement I just made that no one ever believes. It's just amazing to me that no one believes it, but everything that's been true of objects is true of arrays. And so the fact that 9 was logged here, just like it was logged with objects, we can carry that same conclusion forward and say, if this works for objects, it'll work for arrays. So it's also going to log cat. Heads up, no matter who I called on, that was going to happen. Trust me. Okay, next question. What's going to be logged? Now, I'll throw you for a loop. With the orange shirt on. Yep. What do we expect to be logged in this for loop?
9 and cat.
Nine and cat. Yep. X and 0, yes.
X
what is actually going to be logged since this is an array? Yeah, it's still going to do the same thing. You got it. You're absolutely correct. Okay. I'm too tickled by that. It's just ridiculous. Okay. So, what is interesting about arrays? Why do we even have them? If they're so identical to objects, if they're so unembellished, what are they for? Arrays give you two things that objects don't. One, they are under the hood, just really fast for array type interactions. So you'll never know it, but the interpreter is doing very different stuff with how it allocates memory and whatnot. And ideally, you probably won't have to engage with those principles when you're using the array. It'll just run faster. So that's the first thing that an array gives you. If you know you're going to store sequences of data that relate to like ordinally sequenced from 0 to some series to some top number, then you use an array and you can expect things to go faster. The second thing that you get is some convenience properties and methods. Very unobtrusive, right? It's just going to be a method like push. Your object didn't come with dot push. Dot push is just a function stored on an object that will add a new property at the next highest numeric key, right? I mean, you could, if all access can be done using property access, then all push has to do is find out what the highest number we stored something at, go one higher, and put something there. Use that as the key. One higher number than the highest numbered key we have. So, there are some convenience methods, but they are unobtrusive, and they do not interact with the property access story we've already told. One of those conveniences is the length property. Length is going to be kind of like a function call, because it'll always be correct and up to date. But you don't have to put parens on it. It's just a constantly correct property. where correct means it tells you what the highest index is plus one. So in this case, ooh, tough one. You there. Just, yeah, you there. You just tilted your head. What do you expect to be logged when we log array.length here?
Two.
Two. How did you arrive at the number two? There are two properties. Okay, so this is a rule I haven't told you yet, so it's okay that you didn't get that one, but here's what you didn't get right. That looks right. But the way the length works is not that it counts the number of properties, which would be one reasonable interpretation. The way length works is it finds the highest numbered key, and it tells you one higher than that. That is the way that we are going to get access to only the numeric properties when we're talking about the array stuff. Dot length is made as a convenience for the array type access, and so by not considering the stringy keys, only considering the keys that look sort of digit-like, the length property can behave like other languages. So we take the number 0, which is the highest numeric key we have, we add 1, and that's the length.
So when you're initializing this array and you're setting these variables, what if you skip a few numbers? You go from like, you set 0 to set like 5.
Let's say your question amounts to, what if you had an array object and you set one property on it with the key 5 million? What is the length? The length is 5 million and 1. You've also had a bit of a performance issue because under the hood, it's going to allocate 5 million spots in your array.
So you can treat an array like a hash map, and it only behaves like an array if you treat it like an array.
Exactly. Arrays are in every way object-like, with the exception that they have some conveniences tacked onto them. You can simply interact with numeric keys, and it'll behave the way you would expect an array to. This is very confusing for people coming from any other language because it's so dissimilar from other languages, but it's super accessible for people who are first learning to code because it does away with a bunch of complexity we had to learn when we were learning our C-like languages, the Java-like languages. Yeah?
So is length a property or is it a function?
Great question. Is length a property or a function? Length is a property because you can access it using dot without any parens next to the identifier dot length.
Right, so when does it get updated?
So that's the crazy thing about length and the reason that it deserves an entire slide. It gets updated all the time. Whenever you interact with the array object in this case, the ARR object, length is, by the interpreter, kept up to date. So the interpreter says, uh-oh, looks like they interacted with one of the numeric properties. I better change length to be a new value. Invisibly, it'll always be correct. This is the only property you can expect to be always correct. Have you guys played with the browser, the DOM API at all, and tried like .innerHTML? You know how .innerHTML is always correct, even after you've mutated the DOM node? Some of you, this will be familiar territory. You say .append, and you add more DOM nodes into the body, and then you say body.innerHTML. Suddenly, magically, .innerHTML, even though it's a property and not a method call, just has the right string. That's kind of like what's happening. Yeah?
Were you about to say that length can also be accessed through graphic notation?
Yeah, it absolutely can. Yes. You can use quotation marks and brackets around length. So, wait a minute.
Well, so that brought the whole thing back. So are you really, even though you're treating it like a hash map, are you really just adding properties to an array when you don't use integer notation inside the brackets?
Say that one more time for me.
So if you can access quote length inside of brackets on an array, yeah. So that is basically a property accessor using bracket notation. So when you set above, when you set quote X, are you basically just assigning new properties to an array? I guess it's more of a how you're looking at it.
Yeah, so everything that's true of objects is true of arrays. And therefore, if length is a property, we're going to be able to get access to that value at the key length using either dots or brackets. Same is true of x. And that happens regardless of whether it's an object or an array. It's a difficult concept to like really iron down, but it's a simple one, right? Like it's the simplest option.
Well, it's almost like, I don't want to confuse the issue, but it's almost like you have dynamic metadata attached to an array.
For the length property, that's absolutely true. Length is one of the only properties in the language that's automatically kept up to date in the background by the language. Yeah.
So if you're allowed to, I guess, do these string-like keys for arrays, then what happens? Can you edit the length key?
Can I edit the length? You mean, can I say array.length equals 10?
Right.
Yes.
Like, can I change it?
Yeah, you can totally change the length. It has some interesting effects on your array that I encourage you to sort of like noodle with in the browser or in a console somewhere. Punchline, it's kind of Procrustean in the sense that when you set a number that's too low, it just lops off all of the extra numbers. When you set a number that's too high, it adds a bunch of undefined values. But if you didn't track on that, don't worry about it.
But it won't stick, right?
It'll stick.
If you manipulate the array, won't it recalc and change?
Manipulating the length is manipulating the array. So to say, hey length, I want you to be different, has the effect of mutating the array.
Right, but then if you do a push on the array, does the length
change? No, you've mutated it.
Uh-huh.
So pushing extends wherever you... This is something I actually think you should play with in the console, just because I know that it's super interesting, but that it won't help us with the points I'm trying to make.
So if you like iterate through the keys like that, you get an x and zero. Is there a way to iterate just through the numeric keys?
There is. We're about to see it.
Okay.
Before we move on, I'd like to just meditate on how awesome the use of the word Procrustean that was. Is that cool? All right. It's okay. Look it up. So this is an interesting issue. What happened here? We have a length property. Why was it not enumerated when we iterated across all of the properties? It's an array. It was an array since the very start. So at this moment, it had a length property as soon as it came into existence. So when we iterated across 4 var k in ARR, where was length? Any theories? If you were writing this language, you would certainly want this to be true. Nobody even noticed that it didn't happen, right? So clearly this is expected behavior. But we also need this length property. So you're writing a language. What do? You want this to work this way, but you want this to work this way. And then you start thinking, wait a minute, I'm going to need a lot of this. ToString. ToString is a method on every object. I'm going to need that not to show up as well. I need a whole way of handling this. So the language offers what's called unenumerable properties. It's just a special flag that gets set internally, and it prevents the property from being visited during iteration. You don't get to set enumerability until recent versions of JavaScript. So generally, any properties you put in an object, you should expect it to get logged. I'm going to modify the code a little bit. I'm going to set not one, but two different properties of array, numeric properties. And I'm curious what you think is going to be logged here. I'm not going to call any for this one. It's going to be x, 0, and 1. And down here, this is going to be 2. Because there are two properties, or sorry, there are two numeric properties. We take the highest number, 1, we increment it, 2, so the length is 2, and of course it's one of the keys, so we better talk about it. This is where the math comes in. We're allowed to do math, and this is the answer to your question that I said I would get to eventually. We're allowed to do math like the length minus 1 in order to get access to the last item. And because that number, length minus 1, gets stringified, we get access to array bracket 1, which is the last item. It behaves as expected only because of key stringification in conjunction with putting a mathematical operation in between the brackets. Does that clear up? Does that justify, I think, the otherwise confusing interoperability of strings and non-strings?
Yeah.
All right, we can come back to it if you come up with another sort of.
No, it does. I mean, I get it in the context you're going at. Sure. I just think from picking a pattern, you're going to go out.
As a language design choice, it's a surprise, certainly. Yeah.
Will it support like minus 1 to go?
Oh, just negative 1 to be the. No, it will not. Some languages give you a clever syntax for array, bracket, and then negative 1 inside the brackets. This one doesn't. It's really sad. CoffeeScript does.
Yeah.
Any other questions? Yeah.
So, what truly happened to array x? Because the sin said you can't log it and it still holds a value of 9, but when you're actually curating over it, it only uses it on the numeric portion of it.
Well, check this out. Here it is. I enumerated, or I iterated, and it showed up in the list, right? So it's still manifesting.
But the length is 2 instead of being 3.
Well, length is a convenience provided for arrays. The question was, why is length only 2? I mean, doesn't that seem to has that evicted x or ignored it in some way? It's specifically trying to ignore it. The length property as a convenience for array access, which is to say, trying to access one of these orderly sequenced values, length should really only talk about the numeric properties. And so since that convenience, the length property, is only introduced to help you interact with it as an array, as the numeric aspects of it, we don't actually want it to consider x.
So is there another property that counts the actual number of elements in the array?
There is not. There is no way, well, there is a way. There is no property that reflects how many properties are on the object, how many enumerable properties. What you could do is you could call object.keys on it, get a list of the keys, and check the length of that.
So you don't have something like array.size?
Well, dot length is equivalent to dot size. They mean the same thing.
They will give you 2.
In this case, yes, there's 1, 2 of them. So this tells you, length tells you 2. It does not tell you 3, because it's not counting, it's not talking about alphabetical properties. Behind you, I'm curious, when would you care to know the number of properties on an object? Can you think of a program or an instance, a situation where that would be interesting? So you're thinking like, so you're using Python, so you probably have like keys that are like, you can use an object as a key, right? Got it. So in other languages where you can have non-string keys, you would use a hash map for like set and things like that, so you can dedupe things. And you'd use the key side of a hash table as a special kind of array. But since you can only have strings in JavaScript, that's one reason you would. I have never run into, very rarely have I run into needing to know the number of properties unless I'm already just going to iterate over them anyway. But yeah, makes sense. If I were to say array.length, I'm going to get undefined because array.length is 1 higher than the last digit, right? The highest numeric index. So never put array.length in between the brackets. Obviously, you need to subtract 1 in order to get the last item. Make sense? Any questions about that? Yeah?
Just a quick question. Now that you have 3 objects in that array, it doesn't make block 3.
Now that there are 3 properties on array, shouldn't length log 3? No, because length is calculated this way. Take the highest numbered index, the highest numbered key, which is what in this case? it's the one, and you add one to that. That's how length is calculated. Length is not counting the number of properties on an object. It's telling you what the one more than the highest numeric index is, which maps directly to what you would want from an array. You don't want an array to consider its string type property keys. Yep.
So if you're using an array, why would you use key pair values? Why wouldn't you just say array.push XYZ?
So the question is, in what circumstances would we ever find ourselves wanting to store properties on an array that aren't numerically indexed, that use like a key, like X? If I had an object called book, and book had, you know, every page was a different number. So I'm going to use an array so that I can add pages to the end. It's a notebook. But then I also have notebook.owner and notebook.cover and notebook.a bunch of metadata about my notebook. It might be useful to store a bunch of data in a sequence and also talk about that data set using string keys. Great question. Yeah.
So length is a string key, and X is a string key, but when you iterate, you don't get length.
You don't get length and you do get X, because X was added by the programmer right here on this line, and so it was automatically enumerable. But the language added length for us, and it made it unenumerable. A certain number of properties and methods are unenumerable so that they don't show up when you're doing this. That's really all unenumerable means. It means, will you see it when you do one of these loops?
How do I get the value of k?
Log, what do you mean the value of k? Oh, the value stored at key k.
Yes.
So in here you would say log arr bracket k, and you'd use k just like an array, or a k just like a variable. Earlier, when we put key in between brackets, we said this could be get the letter from user, right? It's a dynamically provided value. We would do the same thing here. We would say log arr bracket k end bracket.
Can't do k dot value.
K dot value. Well, k is a string. So k is the string x and the string 0 and the string 1. None of those strings have a dot value property on them, because they're strings. I mean, you wouldn't expect a brand new string to have a dot value on it, would you? For the same reason, we wouldn't use dot access on k, because k holds a bunch of random strings. Great question. So, this log's undefined because accessing 2 is undefined. The last of the things that arrays give us, or rather, the last of these conveniences, are methods that interact with numeric properties. So push, force, should add a brand new element into the collection, but it will do it at the next highest key, the next highest numeric key, after the last one in line. So the last one in line right now is you there. That's the last highest one currently specified up here. Yeah, the last highest numeric key specified.
What?
1. So, when I push horse, where will horse be stored?
2.
Sorry?
2.
2, exactly. All right, you guys are on board. Now the length is 3. Up here it was still 2, but after pushing, the length has been automatically updated, as promised. Any questions? What if you want to only visit the numeric keys? Someone asked that recently. You use a different language construct, and this is one that people get confused. People frequently confuse these two for loops, and they wonder, which one am I supposed to use, and how are they different? It's quite simple. This one does what we claimed in the first place it would do. It iterates across every key in the object. Separately, there's a construct that allows us to start a value somewhere and just march upward until this condition is false. Here's the marching upward. I mean, these are like legible instructions. You could read this and infer what it does. At no point would you expect I ever to hold the value, quote, x. Right? I is starting at 0 and proceeding all the way to length minus 1. Just by reading the code, we can see that to be true. So you use this construct when you want to visit all the numeric keys in order. It's basically syntactic sugar for a bunch of code in a while loop. You can say while, you can say var index equals 0, while index is less than limit. Do some work and then index plus plus. That's basically this reformatting. So what is this going to log you there? So horse got erased. Apologies for that. I erased the horse part. So what do you expect to show up on the screen?
In this case, it's just going to go 0, 1, 2, just go through i.
Exactly. Where I will eventually be 1.
Yep.
1 is the highest number this will reach. So it will log 0 and 1. When you're using arrays, you're probably going to do the lower one. You're almost never going to be curious about what are all the properties on this array, including the string ones. You're probably going to be doing the second of these two patterns. When we were talking about objects, we were using the red one, because objects don't tend to store numeric properties. You would use an array when you have sequences. One thing I'd like to point out is that these things down here appear to be numbers, and these appear to be strings. That's kind of weird, right? We're logging the strings when we use this pattern, and logging numbers when we use this pattern. Rather simply, we aren't extracting keys from this object. We're just marching through numbers. I has got instructions right here to start out as a number and to increment to a new number, and it's only because of key stringification that I would ever get access to the string property. But notice I'm not even interacting with array other than to check the link. Okay, let's change this from array, let's change it back to object and ask ourselves about these new features, these added conveniences that are made available as array for arrays. The things that are important here is that, first of all, there is no length property on an object, unless it's an array. So this wouldn't work, and therefore none of this would behave as expected. This is undefined, so this would never run. If I was to specify the length, then this would work. And that's why I wanted to say at the beginning that these new additions are just conveniences. By specifying length as 2, I make this whole thing behave correctly, because I'm manually reinforcing the sequence-y nature of this thing. This is how jQuery works. jQuery does not subclass array. It's very difficult to subclass native types. You don't need to know that, but if you were going to go hack jQuery, that's something you would encounter. So, since jQuery does not have the ability to be an array, right, the jQuery objects that you get, they are not themselves arrays, and yet you can iterate over them using for loops and for in loops, and pass them to helper functions in like underscore and it still works. That's because jQuery keeps the dot length property up to date manually. It's not magically handled for you by the interpreter, but the jQuery library has code to manage this in the background. Make sense? All right, yes?
So if you were to write that last script, you would have to manually update length if you wanted it to operate like an array.
Assuming you're going to keep adding properties to the object that you're using as a ordinal sequence, yes, you would have to manually change length all the time. Actually, that's exactly right. Okay. Functions as objects. I'm going to rather race through this, because we meditated to some degree on exactly how similar arrays were to objects. And I won't torture you by calling on you to say the following sentence, even though it's true. Functions are just like objects too. They're just everything we talked about objects, true of functions. Your brain is perhaps already warring against this fact. No, they must be different. They're the same. A function is just an object. It's got a special feature. I'll show you that feature in a minute. But the answer to all of the questions I'm about to ask, for the most part, are going to be, well, whatever the object thing did. That's what a function is going to do. Okay, here we have a function that I'm using in place of the old object. And I'm doing all the same stuff to it. Looks familiar? I'm iterating over it with this for loop. I'm iterating over it with that for loop. So what's going to happen? Let's cross everything out and start over and ask ourselves what's going to happen. I lied. I am going to torture you. What's that going to do?
So it's going to set those as properties on the function, right?
Uh-huh.
And it's going to iterate the properties?
Iterate happens down here. What's happening with these question marks?
Oh, I'm sorry. So that's going to produce 9.
Give that man like 11 t-shirts. He's absolutely right. It's just like an object. All right. Therefore, accessing any key on an object, including numeric keys or special character keys, it does the unsurprising thing. It is only surprising if you came here knowing another language. You were like, oh, it's got to have all this crazy stuff to support. No, it's just object and property access. So cat is what's logged at key 0 because we set 0 to cat up here. Same rules. Down here, we're going to iterate all across all of the keys in the function object, which, unsurprisingly, is going to be all 3 of these keys. Okay. What is fun.length? What do you expect fun.length to be with the red here?
Yes.
Would you call it red, or is that just the lighting?
No, yes, it's red. Yes. Okay. Sorry, I like my like red shirt. I'm like, okay. I'm not wearing red today. What do you expect length to be would be 2.
Why do you expect length to be 2?
Because it was for the object.
It was for the array.
Oh.
Remember, arrays have a
set. It would be undefined.
Yes. So, caveat, I'm lying right now. But you should expect this to be undefined, because it's never been set. Arrays come with this convenience thing, length, that is set to however, whatever the highest numeric index plus 1. But that's not useful for functions, so it's not going to do that. As it happens, functions have a coincidentally named property that reflects some other thing. But I just want to focus on our intuition that it would be undefined, and I want to reinforce that you would be correct to believe that. There is a different feature that happens to use the same name that I'm ignoring for the purpose of this slide. So it should log undefined. Zero, in fact. Down here, since length is not going to be, if and in this case hypothetically it's undefined, this will never run either. So we of course are going to delete all of this iteration code. We're never going to iterate across a function like this because it doesn't store ordinally sequenced sets of data, right? I'm deleting. What is a function good for? The only thing that's useful about a function is the fact that you can invoke it. So if I made a statue, I'm going to give an analogy to objects and functions as being similar to statues and machines. If I build a statue and I give it to you, and it's got like some post-it notes on the outside, because it's, you know, it's got like properties on it. It's got a post-it note saying, the color of this object, this statue is black. And the weight of this thing is 2 pounds, right? You can stick things to the outside that talk about that object and give you information about it. The same would be true if I gave you a blender. I could stick a post-it note to the outside that says, this blender is black. This blender is 2 pounds. The only difference between the statue and the blender is the blender has an on button. That is a perfect analogy for the difference between objects and functions. Functions are objects, just like regular objects. They have properties. You can add properties to them, you can inspect those properties, you can take them off. The only difference is these two parens right here, that's an on button. That's me activating the machine that is this function. Other languages don't let you pass functions around as values, like every other value. C, Java, they don't let you address a function directly. You don't get a reference to a function in any case. JavaScript treats a function as just an object that you can press a button on it if you want. So, when you do that, what's going to happen? Whatever code is between these two curly braces, what happens? While we were defining the function, we had the opportunity to put some more lines of code in between the curly braces, and that's what's going to happen when we press the on button. What is going to happen, though, when we press the on button?
Nothing right now.
Nothing right now, but the stuff in between the curly braces. Yes. All right, just checking. We're all here. What I want you to avoid getting confused about, and you're going to be tempted as the slides evolve, do not confuse the area between these two curly braces with the rest of the code. It doesn't run as soon as it appears. It only runs when it gets called. And the other thing I don't want you to confuse it with is the properties of the function. This is the easier one to get confused with. There is no relationship between what I put in between these curly braces and the properties that I eventually add to the outside, the post-it notes that I stick onto the blender. There's no relationship between the gears and what happens when you press the on button and those post-it notes on the outside. Make sense? So, nothing that appears in between these curly braces is going to have any impact or influence over the properties stored on the function object itself. There will be zero interaction between the two. Are there any questions about that? Have I said it, could I be clearer about that? I feel like it's a difficult sentence to get out in a clear way. There's no interaction between the body of the function and the property stored on the function. Okay. So there's currently nothing in there, so nothing's going to happen. But you could imagine that I might write code in there, like log2. And when I call the function, that's when this work happens. The interpreter started up here, and walked all the way through doing all this work, but it did not do the blue work until we all got all the way down here, and the control flow hopped up into the center of this function, did that work, and then hopped back down. That's why 2 got logged. It did not get logged up here because that code was not going to run until later. It's kind of like an if block doesn't run if the condition isn't true. The body of a function doesn't run immediately. It runs later when you call it. I'm allowed to use variables to store the result. So calling a function evaluates to something. What do you expect this function to evaluate to in the black? Looking at this function here, F-U-N-C-T-I-O-N, paren, curly brace, space, log, 2, semicolon, curly brace, semicolon. What should that evaluate to?
Undefined.
Very good. The reason that would be undefined is this doesn't return anything. In JavaScript, you must return something in order for a function expression to evaluate to anything. So, if we take out log2 and we insert a return statement, that means this function call, this invocation of that, will evaluate to, will return the value specified, and this variable will now hold the result of having called it. Let's move on to a function. 11:11. We started at 9:45, 9:50. Let's take a break. So, I will open up the first slide that's got the link to the curriculum on it. If you're interested in working through that curriculum, it'll cover some of the same concepts. You're welcome to blow through it and go all the way to the end if you want. We will continue this talk series in here at the pace that the people in here are moving. There's a rough schedule that I'm going to try to stick to in case people are coming from the outside, but honestly, you guys are the primary audience, so if we need to dwell on something or move faster through something, that's kind of what I'm going to do. So, let's give you guys, let me check the real schedule real quick. At 11:30, we're supposed to move on to scopes and closures. I think we can do so. So you'll have 20 minutes right now to work through the assignments of object arrays and functions, and then at 11:30 we'll reconvene to talk more about scopes and closures. Yes, you there. If you have any difficulty getting your repo downloaded at the end of the link that I just showed you, jsconf2014.hackreactor.com, just raise your hand, one of the TAs will come find you and make sure that you can get that Git repo cloned.